Good morning. Welcome to Grace Bible Church. We're going to worship together. Stand to your feet. If it's your first time here, welcome. And if it's not your first time here, welcome. We're glad you're here today. So let's stand to our feet. We're going to worship God together.
Sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the one that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. Sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. Not to love about you, then and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. Sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Sing, sing, sing.
We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. Make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Sing, sing, sing. One more time.
Sing, sing, sing. And make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Blessed be your name, In the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Oh, and blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away. Take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
Coming on the clouds, kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? And our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. And our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? And our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battle. And every knee will bow before him. And our God is the Lamb that was slain. For the sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? And our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battle. And every knee will bow before him. And our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chain. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. And every knee will bow before him.
Amen. I like that song.
To the cross I look. To the cross I cling. Of its suffering I do dream. Of its work I do sing. For on it my Savior, both bruised and crushed, showed that God is love. God is just. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. Thank you. priceless gift, undeserved life. Have I been given through Christ crucified? You called me out of death. You called me into life. And I was under your wrath. Now through the cross I'm reconciled. And at the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. You know the cross I must confess. How wondrous your redeeming love, and how great is your faithfulness. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I am sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. At the cross you beckon me, you draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. Yeah, yeah. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I'm sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
This time we're going to dismiss the children for Children's Church. Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind, and God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. Never sinned, but suffered as if he did. And all authority, every victory is yours. And all authority, and every victory.
power in hand, speaking the Father's plan, and sending us out a light in this broken land. And all authority and every victory is yours. All authority and every victory is yours. And say, the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcomes. And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcomes. And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise. Jesus, awesome and powerful forever, and awesome and great is your name, you overcame. And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. And we will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome. Will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony, everyone overcome.
You may be seated.
Well, if you have your Bibles with you, I invite you to open your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 17. And last week began to look at the idea of living the Christian life as it is in faith. And we as believers in Christ for our salvation and Christ alone for our salvation believe that the Bible teaches us that it is a life of faith that we walk and that we live. And we recognize that, though, that to live this life of faith, that it's hard. It's hard work, right? And that it's a fight. And actually, the Bible speaks of that. The Apostle Paul told young Timothy, he tells Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:12, he says, fight the good fight of faith. take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So he's like, Timothy, fight the good fight of faith, right? Take hold of it, he's telling him, right? And so the life of faith is a fight. Paul says to the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 16:13, he says, be on alert, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong. And the idea there is what? That faith is a fight, right? To stand firm in that faith is a fight. Be strong. And towards the end of his life, the Apostle Paul says to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:7, he says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. I have kept the faith. And that is our goal as believers, right? To finish the course by keeping the faith. So faith is a fight. And last week we began to look at a young man, a teenage boy that fought a giant who was opposed to his faith, right? We began to look at David, right, who fought a literal giant, Goliath. It isn't just a fairy tale or a children's story. It's a historical account. David is a real person, king of Israel, right, eventually. Goliath is a real person. We looked at that last week. And we began to look at that time in David's life when he went up against Goliath. And the setting was simple last week, right? You have the Philistines, who have always been kind of a thorn in the side of Israel, right? And have always been opposed to Yahweh and his people. And they are camped outside of Jerusalem on the hillside in the valley of Elah, that's south of Jerusalem. And they're on one side of this mountain, on the opposite side of that valley, on another mountain is Israel. And the Philistines, by way of Goliath, this 9.5-foot, right, giant from Gath, comes out and challenges Israel to send someone out and fight him. And whoever wins that battle, whoever kills the other one, then that clan, that nation will be the slave of the others, right? And so what has been happening is that every day, twice a day, the scriptures say for 40 days it went on, they would come out on the prospective hill, they would shout war cries to each other, Goliath would come out and challenge, and Israel would have no one to go against him. Now David has three older brothers that are out on the front lines with Saul, with King Saul, and David is back home with his father, Jesse, and he's tending sheep, and his father gets this idea. He's like, I wonder what's going on the front line, and I wonder how my other sons are. So he puts together a care package, and he tells David, go take this to your brothers, right, and bring back word to me of what's going on, right? And so we looked at all this last week. David goes out, finds them, and it just so happens the time he gets there that they're on their prospective mountains, and David gets there, and he hears, right, Goliath give this great challenge again to Israel. And he sees that everyone in Israel, the armies of Israel, just kind of cower and are frightened, stuck in their boots right there. And he looks around and asks his brothers first. He says, if you remember, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should taunt the armies of the living God? And the brothers get very bothered by this because he's questioning a couple things. He's questioning their courage, but more than that, he's questioning their allegiance to God, right? That it's not so great here. And yet they see in David, this young little teenager, this great faith in God, and such a great faith that he doesn't fear this giant. And it doesn't even seem, as we looked at last week, that he sees a giant, does he? Right? He sees an uncircumcised Philistine that would dare taunt the armies of God. And so here's this little squirt of a boy, and he's turning to his brothers, and then he starts turning to all the Israelites, and he's questioning them like, well, who is this guy? You know, basically, why are you guys not just taking him, right? Because David knows God has told Israel, I've given you this land, right? You'll have to fight for it, but I've already won the battle. When you go there, take it. I've given it to you. The battle will be yours, right? But Israel's faith is frozen. It's dwarfed by the giant. But David, as we saw last week, didn't see this giant as a giant, right? He saw an uncircumcised Philistine, a non-follower of Yahweh. He saw someone with so much contempt for God that he would taunt God's own army, right? He never turned to his brothers and say, boy, this guy is big. He never even mentions his size, right? So in essence, he's saying, how dare you guys, right? Who would this guy think he is that he would taunt God's army? And so then David goes to Saul, as we saw last week, King Saul, and says, and he says to him, let no man's heart fail on account of him, the Goliath. Your servant will go and fight this Philistine, he tells him. I'll go fight him. And Saul said to David, if you remember, you're not able to fight. You're not able to go against the Philistine to fight with him. He says, for you are but a youth while he is a warrior from his youth, right? And so here you have David and Saul, both Israelites, but they were focused on different things. David looked at God, and Saul was looking at David, right? And David looks at God, his history with Israel, his promises to Israel, his history with David himself, how God had been with him. And so Saul looks at David and says, no way. But David looks at God and says, no problem, right? No problem. And so our first characteristic, as we began last week, our first characteristic of how to fight for faith in our Christian life, found in David, right, is this. A fight for faith is a fight to see and to know God in all his glory, might, and wonder. The point is, David's God was so big that he didn't see a giant, right? In David's eyes, God was huge. In David's eyes, God keeps his promises. In David's eyes, God is all-powerful and able to keep his promises, right? In David's eyes, God is holy and just and righteous and sovereign. He knows the beginning from the end. A.W. Tozer, in a book called The Knowledge of the Holy, if you've ever read that book, it's an older book, but it's a book you should read. And he says this, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. For this reason, the gravest question before the church is always God himself. And the most portentous fact about any man is not what he at any given time may say or do, but what he is in his deep heart conceives God to be like. You see? And that's the point. In David's deep heart, he saw God is in control of all things. He saw God is all-powerful. If he promised something, then it's done. And that's where we left off last week. So let's pick that up in verse 34 this week and look at a couple more principles of our fight for faith. In verse 34, 1 Samuel 17. So David is speaking to King Saul, and he told him, I'll go fight. And Saul's like, I don't think so, right? You're just a lad. And David says to Saul there, your servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock. I went out after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Then he says, your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. And this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. Now, the literal Hebrew translation is so much better. It's a beautiful play on words, and you could see even some contempt in David's word. The more proper translation is, the Lord has delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear. He will deliver me from the paw of this Philistine. You see, to David, he's just another animal, like a lion or a bear. He just has, you know, he's just going to come out and paw at me, and God's going to give him to me. The Lord will deliver me. And that's the second principle in the fight for faith. And it is this, is that you have to be an active participant in the fight. You have to be an active participant in the fight. What do I mean? I mean you must take a pass. You can't take a passive approach in your fight for faith. It's not let go and let God, right? David's victory over a bear and a lion was due to David's, what? Was it due to his ability, his strength, or his size, right? No, it was Yahweh. It was Yahweh on his side. And because Yahweh was on his side, he could walk up to a bear, snatch back his lamb, grab the bear by the head and take him, right? I've heard Christians say, I don't see God doing anything in my life. And my answer to that usually is, that's probably because you don't attribute to God anything that's being done in your life. You don't attribute anything that's being done in your life. You see, David went to work, and if he did his job well, he attributed to God working in his life, right? If he did his job above average, it was God working in him. If he played the harp well, it was because God was working in him, right? All his successes weren't his might, wasn't his wisdom, his strength. It was God working in him. And so David's like, if God can use me to protect my father's sheep from lions and bears, then he surely will use me to accomplish what he has already promised. Listen to what Spurgeon says here. I love what Spurgeon here and how he makes this same point. He says, in David's confidence, there's a blending of the human with the divine. Observe, your servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them. That is the human, he says. That's the human. I lost the page. And he goes on, he says, David said, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of this Philistine. That is the divine side of it. In God's word, the car of truth runs on two rails of parallel statements. A great many people want to pull up one of the rails. They will not accept two sets of truth. He says, predestination and free agency do not agree. So the modern Solomons assert, right? Who said that they do not agree? They do agree as fully as two rails on the tram line. But some narrow spirits must set aside either the one or the other. They cannot accept both. This has long been a puzzle on paper, Spurgeon says, but in practice, it is easy. So hear the practical action of the believer, throwing his whole might into his master's service, perfectly agrees with his falling back upon the working of God and knowing that it is God that works all things for him. David's slaying of the lion and the bear and the Philistine is clear, but God's delivering him out of the jaw of the lion, the paw of the bear, and the hand of the Philistine is equally clear. I love this part. He says, make it plain to yourself. I believe when I preach, I ought to preach and study my sermon as if its success altogether depends on me. But that when I am thus thoroughly finished, I am to trust God as much as if I had done nothing at all. The same view should be taken of your life and of your service for God. Work as if you were to be saved by your works, and then trust Christ alone, since it is only by faith in him that you are capable of a single good work. Work for God with all your might as if you did it all. But then always remember that it is God. It is God which works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. How is that Philistine to be killed? By God, says one. True, but not without David. By David, says another. Yes, but not without God. Was David courageous? You bet he was, right? Was it his courage or God's courage through him that conquered that bear and a lion and will conquer Goliath? And the answer to that question is yes. Yes, right. Look what the Apostle Paul says. 1 Corinthians 15:10. He says, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace towards me did not prove vain, right? I am what I am because of the grace of God. And then he says, but I labor even more than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God with me. Well, which is it, Paul? Is it your labor or is it God's grace in your life? And the answer to that question is yes, right? It's yes. In Colossians 1:29, he tells the Colossian church, for this purpose also I labor, striving according to his power, which mightily works within me. Paul says, I labor, I strive, yet according to the power which mightily works within me. Paul doesn't say in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me, and then take a seat in the easy chair, right? No, he gets out and he strives and he works. A fight for faith, says God, right? And that fight for faith says God has promised, right? God is more than able. And then in that fight for faith, you step out and you work hard. Now back to the story here. Verse 37, and Saul said to David, go and may the Lord be with you. Saul's convinced, I might as well send this man. His faith is huge, right? And then we have an act of genuine sincerity from Saul. Saul has a love for David, so in his flesh, he wants to give him the best fleshly chance. And so he tells him, verse 38, it says, then Saul clothed David with his garments and put a bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with armor. David girded his sword over his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. So David said to Saul, I can't go with these, for I've not tested them. And David took them off. You know, Saul is very sincere. He wants to give David his best chance here, and he gives him his own armor. But if you remember, right, Saul is, Scripture tells us, head and shoulders above everyone in Israel. And David is a little runt of a boy. I mean, David is not going to be able to even walk in his armor. And so David, like, he takes it off. He's like, no, this isn't going to work. Verse 40, he took a stick in his hand and chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, even in his pouch. And his sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistines. So David says, no, I'm going to take something that I'm familiar with here, right? My slingshot, right? The Israelites were very proficient with a slingshot. It was one of their weapons of choice. In Judges 20:16, you have the Benjamites. They had 700 left-handed slingers, it said there, who could hit a hare at a great distance. And the stones they used were usually about 2 and 3 inches in diameter, and it was said that they could swing those out about 200 feet per second. And it hit an object, and it was able to crush a bone with 5,000 foot-pounds of energy, right? So this is a weapon that David knows. And so why does David choose this slingshot? Well, like I said, is it his best defense? Is there something spiritual about the slingshot? Had God told David to use the slingshot? None of those, right? None of those. David used a natural thing available to him unless God was to tell him something else. David used his wisdom here and walked out, said, I'm going to do this for God. He hasn't said, take this weapon or that weapon. I'm going to use my wisdom. I'm going to choose, which is a third principle of my fight for faith. When fighting your giant, use the natural things available to you. God often uses natural means to gain spiritual victories in your life, doesn't he? If you need a life-saving surgery, you go after it, don't you? Right? And at the same time, you pray to God. Right? At the same time, you pray to God. You pray that his hands would guide that surgeon. You know, at the same time, it's in God's sovereign hand. when we go up against our giants, we're not to test the living God. You're not to put out fleece. It's childish. But you do say, thank you, Lord. I have the victory. I love what Jonathan Wright says. He's like, I get to a situation and I'm really not sure to go right or left. All I can be sure of is at that moment and where God wants me to be, right? And I'll take step by step, saying, God, this is where you want me, right? So David is going out and he's like, God, I don't know how you're going to give it to me, but I know it's mine, right? So I'm going to do whatever is normal and natural and obvious, and I'm going to prepare myself the way that I know how. I will use this mind that you gave me, but I'm going to put it in low gear and I'm going to head out. And that's exactly what David did. Look at verse 41. Then the Philistine came on and approached David with the shield bearer in front of him. And when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy with a handsome appearance. Then the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine also said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the field. Now the Philistine is quite arrogant, right? And he curses David by his God, by Yahweh. And notice David how he answers back here in verses 45 through 47. I think this is one of the greatest statements of faith in all the Bible. In verse 45, David said to the Philistine, you come to me with a sword, a spear, and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. Right? I'm not coming to you with a slingshot, right? I'm coming to you with the Lord of hosts. This day the Lord will deliver you up into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. And I will give the dead bodies of the army of the Philistines to stay to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by the sword or the spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Notice that David does what he does here and what he doesn't do. He doesn't return insult for insult or slander for slander. He doesn't need to boast. He really has not much to boast about in himself, right? Right? It's not really a fight. Not much of a fight if you look at David and Goliath. But when you bring God into the equation, everything changes, doesn't it? And here's the point. Here's number four here in our fight for faith. Don't tell God how big your giants are. Tell your giants how big your God is. Sometimes we can spend so much time telling God over and over and over again just how big the giant is in our life, as if God doesn't know, right? I mean, we just get fixated on that, right? And the Bible tells us God knows that. There's no need to dwell on it. Rather than telling God over and over again just how big your giants are, how about telling your giants how big your God is? You might be thinking, Joe, do you want us to talk to ourselves? And I'm going to say, well, if it helps, go ahead. Right? To fear, what do I say? I say, God says he will never leave me or forsake me. If it's temptation, God says that he will not allow me to be tempted beyond what I can endure without a way out. If it's greed, God says he will supply my needs. Right? If it's persecution, God has told me, greater is he who is in me than he who is in the world. Right? Anxiety, Jesus told us, and which of you by being anxious can add a single hour to his span of life? If then are not able to do a small thing as that, there, why are you anxious about the rest, right? If it's sickness, Psalm 73 reminds us, my flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. If it's fear, Isaiah 41:10 says, so do not fear, for I am with you. And do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with the righteous right hand. I have a favorite thing that I say to myself. I talk to myself, by the way. Right. I have a favorite thing that I say to myself. Every time I find some giant all of a sudden in my life, I find myself in a situation I wasn't planning on, and I just say, well, God, that didn't catch you by surprise. And I don't say it for God, I say it for me, right? I don't say it to remind God that it didn't catch him by surprise. I say it to remind myself, right? Let me tell you where the battle of Goliath was fought and won. It wasn't in the valley. It was in David's mind, wasn't it? Giants win because they change the way that you think about God. They change the way that you think about his word, and they change the way you think about his promises. The battle is for your mind. Here's your battle verse. Write this down. 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. And Paul says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. We don't fight according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortress. We are destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against, look what it says there, against what? Raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. What are those speculations or lofty things? They are any knowledge, any wisdom, any visual force that wages war against what I know to be true about God, the knowledge of God. That's what it is. And by knowledge of God, it doesn't mean to know there's a God. It means knowing God, knowing his character, his attributes, his word, his promises. David is saying, I come to you in the name of all that my God is. That's what he's telling. I come to you in the name of all that my God is. The Lord has already delivered you into my hands. The battle has already been won. And in David's mind, he knows that. The battle is won. And actually, the battle is not much of a battle, is it? Look at verse 48. Then it happened when the Philistines rose and came and drew near to meet David, that David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet the Philistines. And David put his hand into his bag and took from it a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. And the stone sank into his forehead so that he fell on his face to the ground. Howard Hendricks said, that made Goliath the first hippie because he was stoned out of his mind. Verse 50 says, thus David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and he struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in David's hand. And David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of his sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. And when the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. The men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the valley into the gates of Ekron. Oh man, now they got some faith, huh? You know, I mean, now they're not stuck in their boots here, shivering, right? And the sons of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines and plundering their camps. Then David took the Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his weapon in his tent. He got a souvenir. David won the battle of the mind way before the physical battle with the giant, didn't he? And he won that giant battle because he attributed all the battles in his life, down to the smallest, as God being faithful in his life. The battle is not the giant. The battle is not the giants in our life. The battle is for the mind. The giant is Satan's tool against your right thoughts about God. If you can take your mind off God and put it on anything else, right, then he believes, well, I've won a small victory. So the principles in our fight for faith. A fight for faith is to see and to know God in all his glory, all his might, all his wonder. That's where it begins, and that's where we must begin, to know God in a greater and greater and greater way. The fight for faith, you must be an active participant in it. You must get up every day and say, today, I will fight, right? I go to work, I will fight. When I go to school, I will fight. Here's a fight you won't get in trouble for. Not from your parents, anyway, right? Fight for faith. When you're fighting your giants, use the natural things available to you. God has given you wisdom. He will use natural things in that fight. Don't tell God how big your giants are, lastly. Tell your giants, right, how big your God is. How big your God is. Those of you getting baptized, you might want to go start to get ready. Now, before you start thinking, well, this David, he's some super Christian, and we're not, right? And we begin to lift David up on some kind of pedestal. Well, let me remind you, right, that David was not some super Christian. David failed greatly in his life, didn't he? We know of that, right? David failed against some giants in his life. His sins concerning Bathsheba, right, and her husband, Uriah, give evidence that David was not some superhuman Christian. David commits adultery later in his life. He was just like you and me. He had some giants that he could not conquer. He failed. Let me take you to Psalm 51. And here's a psalm where shortly after David failed that giant with Bathsheba. And it says there, the description of Psalm 51 reads, "For the director of music, a psalm of David, when the prophet Nathan came to him after David had committed adultery with Bathsheba." And look what he says here, Psalm 51, verse 1. "Be gracious to me, O God, according to your loving kindness. According to the greatness of your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in innermost being, and the hidden part of you will make me know wisdom. Purify me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me to hear joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with a willing spirit." Now, this psalm here is a whole nother sermon, but let me point out two things. In this psalm here, it's clear David knows that he doesn't deserve forgiveness. So what does he do? He does the same thing when he fights a giant in his life. He calls on God's character. And here he calls on God's character of mercy and love to remove his sins. You see, he goes to the same place. He calls on God's mercy, his unfailing love, and his compassion. And secondly, David acknowledges his sin before God. King David throws himself on God's mercy. He does not make excuses for his sins. Rather, he admits them and then begs God's mercy. We'll call this number 6 on the principle for fight against our giants. When you fail, when not if here, be quick to repent. Be quick to acknowledge your sin and run quickly to the Father of mercy. You see, count on the Father that you know. And finally this morning then, what's the purpose of defeating these giants, right? Why do we want to win the battle against the giants in our life? I mean, if we're honest about it, it's often because we want pain for the relief of sorrow that comes with those giants, right? We want to be maybe lifted up. We like to accomplish fights. We like to win, right? Why did David want to conquer the giant? Why did David defeat the giant? Did he do that so that he would be revered as the greatest? Did he do it so they would write songs about him or make a statue of him, right? So he could become king? None of the above. Look what he said. Remember what he said to Goliath in verse 46? This day the Lord will deliver you up into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you, and I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines to stay to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. What should be our motivation for conquering our giants? So those that are looking at our life will know that there is a God that I belong to that is able. You see, the world doesn't need the holier-than-thou Christian. It needs the sinner saved by grace, suffering against the same giants that everyone else is in the world, but defeating them for all to see that it was not me, but God in me, you see. And also seeing that Christian, when they fail, right, repent. Be honest about the repentance. I would say, parents, be honest to your children when you fail. And tell them, I fail. I've asked God forgiveness, I ask you. You know what we try to do with our giants usually? We often try to hide them or ignore them or replace them with different giants. But we need to be like David, right? We need to be like David. Win the battle in the mind. Fight to see and know God in all his glory, all his wonder, right? Remind ourselves of who God is and what he can do through you, right? Run into the battle. Be a participant of it. Don't tell God how big your giants are. Tell your giants how big God is, right? And when you fail, be quick to repent. Acknowledge again who God is in your life. And do it for the right reason. Do it so that God may be glorified in your life. Let's pray. Worship team, come on. Lord God, thank you for your word this morning. Thank you for the record that you've kept for us for thousands of years of this young man David and his faith that he exhibited for us in the fight of a giant in his life. God, my prayer is that we walk alongside one another, fighting, lifting each other up in our fights for our giants, encouraging one another day by day. Lord God, help us to be the believers. Help us to be those in Christ who are walking in your truth, walking according to your power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you stand with us today?
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord.
You give life.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
You may be seated.
Hello. I'm going to read a passage for us here. The passage is from Matthew 28:18-20, and it reads this: And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, All authority has been given to me in heaven and earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Baptism is a public declaration of personal faith. The act of baptism is to identify with the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And we have a few people to baptize today. And first we have Hadley Runia. And I've got to know Hadley a little bit with soccer. She played on the soccer team with my son. And so I've got to talk to her a little bit. And so Hadley, have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead and come forward here. All right. Let's turn around this way. All right, Hadley. On your profession of faith, go ahead and... On your profession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right. All right, next we have Graham Runia. Graham, come on down. I also got to talk to Graham at soccer, but he wasn't on my son's team. Graham, have you accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right. All right, let's come around this way. All right, Graham, on the basis of your profession of faith in Jesus, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Change baptizers.
You saw my waiters? This is Lila Redmond. She is 9 years old, and we had a good talk a week ago, and she accepted Christ as her Savior a few months ago and such, and we talked, and she had a rough time opening up, so I thought, you know, I'll just play the devil's advocate, and I said, so you're going to get baptized so you can become a Christian, and she quickly corrected me. And said, oh no, baptism doesn't make you a Christian. And she's exactly right, right? She said, no, baptism is a profession of my faith, that I put my faith in Christ alone for my salvation. So we know that she knows the Lord, and she wants to live for him and walk with him in her life. So we're going to baptize her this morning. Let's turn this way. Grab your arm. That's it. Ready? Lila Redmond, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ and your desire to walk with him and to honor him all the days of your life, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hey, Dave, why don't you move that pulpit? This is Marissa Tribble. Marissa's a mother of three little ones that are right there out in front. And Marissa's story is she got baptized in 2015, and it was for the wrong reasons. And she quickly, after baptism, went back to her old life and to not living for Jesus. And she said through many things in her life, the teaching of God's word and the Spirit of God, and her loving husband, she told me, being patient with her and loving her, she come to realize that she had not given her life to Jesus and had not been a change in her life. And so she has since done so and is walking with the Lord and wants the body of Christ to know that she knows the Lord and she is his child and she wants to live for him and obey him and follow him. And so she is coming to be baptized, to give a testimony of that to the body. Is that it? Mm-hmm. All right. Put your head on that. Marissa Tribble, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, your desire to live for him, walk with him, honor him in your life, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is Tegan Forsythe, and she's going to talk for herself here this morning.
I'm Tegan. I've lived here my whole life, and I professed faith in Christ, and I'm excited to be baptized here today.
All right. So Tegan and I also have talked, and she knows the Lord, and she wants the church and the body of Christ and the world to know that she is the Father's through Jesus Christ alone, and she is going to live for him and follow him all the days of her life, right? Tegan Forsythe, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ for your salvation, and because of your desire to walk in him and to follow him and to obey him all the days of your life, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. This one's here. This is Avery Ann Cassiopo. She wanted to use her middle name, and she's going to speak to you.
My name is Avery, and I know that Jesus Christ died on the cross and saved me from my sins. I now have the Holy Spirit in my heart. I want to share my own personal relationship with the Lord my God. I want people to know how much I love the Lord. I love God with all my heart, mind, strength, and soul.
All right. By the way, Avery and Tegan are junior hires, and Avery has given her life to Christ, wants to follow him in her life, and to obey him, and life to be about him. So Avery, because of your profession of faith in Jesus Christ, because of your desire to follow him and to obey him and to make him a part of your life in a great, great way, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This is wonderful this morning, right? We had little all the way up to adults here this morning, given a profession of faith, right? Baptism does not save you, but it tells the world, it tells the body. Tells the body, pray for me, help me. I want to follow Jesus. I want to follow God's word. I want to live for them in my life. So I would encourage you to pray for these that were baptized here this morning. And so I invite you to come back this evening at 5 o'clock. Enjoy us in our fellowship. And with that, we are dismissed. Thank you.